So the final topic I want to cover briefly is scaling of NAND memory. So this is that 8 gigabit chip, and you can hold it on your 8 gigabyte chip. I always keep confusing between bit and byte. So 8 gigabyte chip, and you can hold it on your finger. And I want to cover three main challenges. That is, these are facing the scaling of NAND flash memory. One is the scaling of your tunnel oxide thickness. The other one is your parasitics in your cell. And finally, the 3D NAND architecture, which is just around the horizon as well. So these are some of the scaling challenges. So tunnel oxide thickness, it has become very difficult to scale it, especially scale it below 8 nanometer. The reason is because as I described earlier, if you have a very thin dielectric, you get a lot of defects in it, and you get stress-induced leakage, which tends to kill your retention of the cell. If you try to scale your interpoly dielectric, then what happens is that again you get a large injection of carriers into it. And also it degrades your coupling ratio. So all of these dimensions in your gate stack, that is your tunnel dielectric, your interpoly dielectric, they become difficult to scale. And because they become difficult to scale, it becomes difficult to scale the voltage you require to program and erase these cells. So you still need a very high voltage, and that's why you can't even scale your STI. So you have to do that high aspect ratio edge. The other thing which become even worse is your cell-to-cell capacitance. And I'll describe that more in a few slides. So this is showing the equivalent oxide thickness as different years. And we talked about making these logic transistors and FinFET transistors. So that green line is for logic transistor, and you can see that, you know, it scaled from 10 nanometer in 95 to you know, less than a nanometer in 2010, because we wanted to shrink our gate lengths, we wanted to keep the same electrostatics, so we kept on shrinking this oxide thickness for our CMOS. But look at what's happened in that NAND arena. So these NAND transistors, their tunnel oxide thickness essentially was 10 nanometer in 1990. It was 8 nanometer in 2000, and it is still 8 nanometer in 2010. So think about the electrostatics of these transistors, right? Their gate length is 90 nanometer, and they have a 10 nanometer of gate dielectric. So they have really poor electrostatics. But since it's not a logic device, you really don't care about electrostatics. But this has become one of the sticking block of scaling. And there's a lot of research which is going on. So people are trying, instead of using just oxide, why can't I use oxide nitride? And maybe I can even lower, I can have a slightly higher physical thickness, but a lower EOT, so I can maintain the same retention, but I can program it much faster, because when I'll be programming it, I'll be just seeing the barrier through my oxide. So there's a lot of research which is going on in the area of band engineering your tunnel oxide, but nothing has been which has gone into production yet, because essentially this oxide is very key. The high quality in this oxide is key, because this is the oxide through which your electrons will tunnel in and out more than 100K times. And if you develop traps over here, you'll essentially just degrade your retention. You'll be also closing your program erase window. So that's why people have tried to they have changed everything about the cell, but they haven't changed the tunnel dielectric, because anything you replace your silicon oxide with anything else, just your retention, you're not able to meet your retention requirement. The other thing which has become worse is your floating coupling between these two adjacent floating gates. So the other big problem in scaling is the parasitics. So shown here is this NAND array, and you have these multiple of these transistors. And things were fine when these transistors were far apart, but as you bring them closer, the capacitive coupling between them starts to become a problem. So if you are programming one of these cells, it drives up the voltage in the other cell, and it tries to program as well. So that's you know, there's a big problem which occurs because of this coupling between these two adjacent gates. And we have been avoid. So as I showed you, one way to avoid it was we are wrapping this word line around our cell. So if you look around the word line direction, it wraps around this cell. So one thing it does, it reduces your, it increases your gate coupling ratio. But the another good thing it does is it decreases the coupling between your two adjacent floating gates. So if you look over here, since that line is wrapping around, you don't get as much coupling. As compared to the other direction where that line is not wrapping around, that is along your word line is going this way, so you have a tall floating gate, so you get a lot of coupling between these two adjacent cells. And that is becoming a problem. Another thing which is becoming a problem is that since you wrap that line around to increase your gate coupling ratio, you need a certain thickness to wrap it around, right? So you have at least this interpoly dielectric is, let's say, 7-8 nanometers thick, and you have two of these. So you need at least, you know, 50 nanometer of spacing between these two lines just to achieve that wraparound. And if you want to scale your cell below that, then again that becomes a problem. So these are all open challenges right now. And the parasitics, as I showed you, it's becoming even bigger, bigger and bigger problem. So one way to get around is your parasitic is to insert an air gap. So if you have an air gap, that's a material which has the lowest dielectric constant. And again, people have been doing that as well. So between these two floating gates, you essentially, instead of filling it up with dielectric, you intentionally introduce this air gap. And there's quite a bit of technology that goes into achieving that air gap so uniformly between these two cells, and we'll talk about that next week. But air gap are routinely used in your flash memory to reduce this parasitics. And the last thing which I just want to mention is, and I'll post a couple of videos about, is that if you can't scale them laterally, then the other way to scale is essentially to go vertical, right? So all of these vertical architecture, the one of the main selling point is that you can have a larger lithography feature. So you can have these feature sizes could be hundreds of nanometers, but you could increase your number of bits just by increasing the number of layers. So you can have a vertical pillar, and you can have 32 or 64 cells just by having multiple of these layers which are forming your cell. So this is one of the main selling point of going 3D, that you can control your cost not by lithography but by controlling the number of layers. And this is a different paradigm shift when you go to these 3D devices, that the main selling point is you want to get rid of lithography, but at the same time you want a lot of these layers, right? So that's the current number is somewhere around 64 or 32 layers of these transistors stacked vertically. Again, this is an active area of research, and I'll post multiple videos about it. But each of these companies which is in the flash business has a different architecture, or has a different methodology for doing it. So I want to end it with this. Okay, so let's end with this small, what I like to call it the crystal ball of any memory device. So whenever you have a memory device, you want to look at all these different parameters. You want to look at how is it non-volatile. If I switch off the power, does it say there how fast I can read and write into it? What is the maximum bandwidth I can read and write into it? What is the endurance, right? What is the retention time? What's the maximum temperature I can operate at? What is the cell size, right? So these are all, is it CMOS compatible, if it's, especially if it's an embedded memory. So let's start as, how does NOR compare? So is it non-volatile? Yes, right. Is it fast enough? What is the endurance, right? So can anybody recall how many times I can read and write it? Yeah, so let's look at some of these numbers. So you can read and write it 100,000 times or 10 to power 5. It's non-volatile. That's the read and write time. So you can read it in 25 milliseconds. You can write it at a much smaller speed. So if you do that exercise and try to transfer that file and read it back, you'll see that you have those times. The bandwidth, again, if you transfer your file into your USB, it will see it's somewhere around 25 megabits per second. Let's look at retention, right? So what is the retention? Look at these numbers. So it's not exactly 10 years, especially for an MLC cell, it's not 10 years. It's actually around a year. The energy, we really didn't talk about it, but it's 10 to power 4 picojoules for each of these write and erase operation. And you can calculate, we'll have a homework problem where you'll calculate it, and you'll calculate it for hard disk drive. So hard disk drive is typically an order, it's much higher as compared to this. So it's an energy efficient device to read and write. How about the maximum die size available? What is the maximum die size available? Yeah, 16 gigabyte or 128 gigabit. Cell size, minimum? 4F square, right? So the 64, it's actually this is a year old chart, so it's now 128 gigabit or 16 gigabyte per die. Feature size 4F square. Yeah, and you know, cost is around $1 per gigabyte. So essentially, flash it wins on all these metrics, and there are a lot of competitors to flash memory. So there's an alphabet. There's a full alphabet soup of memories. So there's phase change. There's RRAM. There's conductive bridge RAM, you know, any alphabet you can name, I can name a memory which is competing against. please do attend on Wednesday. It should be another exciting guest talk. So Pranav will actually talk a reel of all these issues from a person who has worked in it for a long time. So it should be exciting.